Hello and welcome to Controller Stack. This is the third video in our STM32 Ethernet series, where we are using the W5500 module for network communication. In the previous video, we learned how to create a TCP server that could receive data from a client device. We also explored how to use the received data to control an LED connected to the microcontroller unit, or MCU. Although the setup worked perfectly, there was one limitation: the server was operating in blocking mode while waiting for data from the client. This meant that during this waiting period, the CPU was essentially idle and unable to handle any other tasks. In today's video, we'll see how to overcome this issue by implementing the TCP server using FreeRTOS. By integrating FreeRTOS, the CPU will be able to manage multiple tasks efficiently, even while waiting for data from the client. This approach allows us to make better use of the system resources and improve the overall performance of the application. We'll continue from the exact point where we left off in the previous video, so you can easily follow along. Let's begin by enabling FreeRTOS in CubeMX and setting up the basic configuration for our project. Open CubeMX inside STM32 Cube IDE. Then, navigate to the middleware section, find FreeRTOS, and enable CMSys version 2 support. We'll keep all the configuration settings as default for now, and then move to the Tasks and Queues section. You'll notice that a default task is already created by CubeMX. Let's rename this task to TCP Receive Task, as it will be responsible for receiving data from the client. Next, make sure to adjust the stack size of this task to at least 512 words, since it will use the receive function and also include some printf statements. These functions require additional stack space, so increasing it ensures the task runs smoothly. The priority of the task is currently set to normal, and we can leave it at that level. Now, you can create additional tasks for other operations you want your system to handle. For instance, in my case, I want to control an LED, so I'll create another task called LED control task. Set the priority of this LED task higher than the received task. This is because the LED task will not only control the LED but also handle sending data back to the client. We don't want the receive task to interrupt or preempt it while it's in the middle of transmitting data. Also, since this LED control task will only execute after the server has received data, assigning it a higher priority is perfectly fine and won't cause any issues. At this point, you may notice that the FreeRTOS heap usage has exceeded its current limit. To fix this, open the parameter configuration and increase the heap size to a suitable value. Once that's done, everything should look good. Next, open the advanced settings and enable the option Use Newlib Reentrancy. This ensures that library functions like printf work correctly in a multi-threaded environment. Then, go to System Core Sys and change the time-based source to any available timer instead of the default sys-tick, since FreeRTOS will handle timing internally. That's all we need to configure for FreeRTOS. Once these settings are complete, click Save to generate the updated project files. Let's start by commenting out the function TCP server blocking loop, so that the program doesn't enter the infinite loop inside this function. We'll now reuse the code from the tcpserver.c file that we created in the previous video. First, copy all the include statements from that file and paste them into the main.c file. Next, define the TCP server socket and port variables in the main file, just like before. After that, copy the portion of code responsible for opening the socket and putting the TCP server in listen mode. Since we only need to execute this part once, place it inside the main function, right after initializing the W5500 module. In simple terms, at the start of the program, we configure a socket to use the TCP protocol on a specified port, and then call the listen function to make the server start listening for incoming client connections. Now, copy the code from the infinite loop of the previous implementation, and paste it inside the infinite loop of the TCP receive task we created in CubeMX. Here, the server will still receive data from the client in blocking mode, but since it's now running under free RTOS, the CPU won't actually stay blocked. While this task waits for data, the scheduler allows other tasks to execute freely, making the system much more efficient. Let's remove the unnecessary parts of the old loop, as we no longer need them. Once the server receives the data from the client, we'll check whether the received string is on or off. If the string matches either command, we'll send a task notification to the LED control task, using different flags to indicate whether to turn the LED on or off. This gives us a simple and reliable way to signal the LED task whenever a valid command is received. The rest of the logic remains the same as explained in the previous video. When the client disconnects, we'll call the disconnect function to properly close the TCP server. Then, we'll restart the server so that a new client can connect again without resetting the system. Before we move on, we still need to define the RX buffer variable used for receiving data. Let's define it at the beginning of the receive task to keep things organized. Next, we'll write the LED control task function. Inside its infinite loop, this task will wait indefinitely for a notification from the receive task. It won't proceed until a notification is received, ensuring it only runs when an actual command arrives from the client. We expect two possible flags, 0x01 and 0x02. The wait function will exit as soon as either of these bits is set, and the flag variable will store the value of the flag that triggered the notification. Using a simple if statement, we'll check which flag was received and then set or reset the LED pin accordingly. After updating the LED state, we'll also send a message back to the client indicating the current LED status. In this setup, the LED control task will only execute when a notification is sent by the receive task, and the receive task will send a notification only when it receives the correct command from the client. This creates a clean and efficient communication pattern between the two tasks. Additionally, you can create other free RTOS tasks to perform periodic operations alongside this process. Those tasks will continue to run independently, while the receive and LED control tasks handle the client-server communication in the background. Let's go ahead and build the project now. You may notice a few warnings, but there are no errors, which means the code is ready to be flashed onto the board. Once the flashing process is complete, our TCP server is up and running. Let's now connect to it using the client application and send a few commands to test it. When we send the commands to turn the LED on and off, you can see that the LED responds correctly, it turns on and off as expected. However, there's an issue. The server isn't able to send data back to the client. After investigating this problem, I found the reason behind it. This issue occurs because the priority of the LED control task was configured lower than the receive task. In this setup, while the LED task is trying to execute, the receive task preempts it, meaning it interrupts and takes over the CPU time. This preemption happens exactly when the LED task is in the middle of sending data to the client, which causes data corruption during transmission. That's why, as I mentioned earlier in the video, it's important to keep the LED task priority higher than the receive task. Let's fix the priority, rebuild the project, and test it again. Now that the server is ready once more, let's connect the client and send the commands to control the LED. This time, you can see everything works perfectly, the LED responds properly, and the client also receives the correct data from the server. This happens because the receive task can no longer preempt the LED control task while it's sending data, ensuring smooth and consistent communication. Also note that if the server receives an unrecognized command, it does not send any response back to the client, This helps keep the communication clean and intentional. So, with this setup, we've successfully created a TCP server using FreeRTOS on STM32. The tasks now work together efficiently, allowing the CPU to manage multiple operations without getting blocked. In the next video of this Ethernet series, we'll take things a step further by programming the STM32 to act as a TCP client, capable of both sending and receiving data from a TCP server. That's all for this video. You can download the complete project from the link provided in the description below. If you have any doubts or questions, feel free to leave them in the comments section. Thank you for watching, and have a great day ahead.